Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining today. My name is Max, Maxim David. As you may hear, I'm coming from France, living in Montreal in Canada. And today we are going to talk about AWS Lambda and more specifically about cold starts. I built a benchmark tool. I don't know if you saw it, but I will show you the link before, after. And the aim of this talk is really to go through this benchmark, why I built it and how it's working. It's 100% serverless. So I hope you like it, and let's dive into the agenda. So obviously, we are going to talk a bit about Lambda function. So who is using Lambda function here? OK, decent crowd. So you are at the right spot today. And obviously, we are going to talk a bit about cold starts and what kind of factors are influencing cold starts. So we are going to see that there are many factors influencing cold starts, and we need a benchmark to see what's happening here. Then we will talk about the architecture of the benchmark. So it's 100% serverless. So be ready for like an Inception-like experience because it's using AWS Lambda to deploy Lambda function and benchmark it. So 100% serverless. And if we have a benchmark, we need to have results. So obviously, we will talk about the results of this benchmark. And finally, what's next? What's next for the tool? What's next for you? What's next for cold start as well? So I'm definitely too coward to bring my own Lambda definition, so I will stick with the AWS one. So yeah, it's basically automatically allocates compute execution powers and runs your code. And what is really important here is it's event-based, and this is going to be super important for the talk. So you need an event to trigger a Lambda function. So it can be S3 events. It can be when you put an item on a bucket, it will trigger a Lambda function. It can be an HTTP event. It can be an event bridge event. So there's a lot of different options to trigger a Lambda function, but you need an event. And what is really important also is that it's for any scale of traffic. So if you don't have any traffic, the Lambda function will be like in a sleeping mode. And the first request which will come to your Lambda function will basically wake up the function. And this is what we call a cold start. And I will dive a bit deeper in cold start in a moment. So basically, when you don't have any traffic and a request is coming to your Lambda, you will experience a cold start. You will also experience a cold start when you have a sudden spike of traffic. Let's say you have, I don't know, 100 transactions per second, and for some reason you have a huge spike of traffic. Then new Lambda will be spawned, and you will experience a cold start as well. So let's have a look at cold starts. So as I mentioned, you need an event. So Lambda will receive an event. And if the first request, or if there's a big spike of requests, you will experience a cold start. And a cold start is split into three different phases. The first one is obviously AWS need to download the code. So it can be a zip, or it can be an OCI image published on ECR. But AWS need to take your code and bring that to the Lambda environment. Then Lambda needs to start the environment. It's a Firecracker VM under the hood, so AWS needs to start that. And finally, there is the initialization code that AWS will run for you. So basically, your Lambda function contains two different ports. The first one is the initialization code, and the second one is really the handler function. So basically, the handler function is the code that will execute for each and every invocation. But if you want to, let's say, connect to a database or initialize S3 clients, maybe you don't want to do that for every request. Maybe you want to delay that to defer that to the init phase. So basically, three steps: download the code, initialize the environment, and start the initialization code. For warm start, so once your Lambda function is already up and running, just the handler code will be triggered, and there is no cold start anymore. So really, first time that your Lambda function is invoked, when you update your configuration, or when you have like a big spike of traffic. And the cool stuff is that you have control on this cold start. Some of these components, you have control on it. So basically, the download code part, you have control on that, because if your package is small, well, it will take less time to actually download it. If your OCI image is extremely small, it will take way less time to download. So if you have control on downloading the code, that's fine, because you have influence on the cold starts. what you can control also is the initialization code. So if you're doing a lot, if you're allocating a lot of memory, obviously the init code will be longer and the curl start will be longer. So let's have a look at factors that are influencing code start. We just talked about that. Code size, obviously, the bigger your code size is, the longer the code start is. Number of allocation as well. So if you allocate a lot of temporary memory or doing a lot of thread pooling or something like that, as long as you keep allocating memory, this will impact cold start because there's a lot of I/O, CPU intensive stuff. The more allocation you have, the longer the cold start will be. Then memory size. On the doc, AWS states that memory size is impacting the number of vCPUs that your Lambda function have. So for 128 megabytes, which is the default, you have two vCPUs. But maybe for more memory size, the number of vCPUs will increase. So does it impact the cold start? We will see that in the result of the benchmark. Another factor is the runtime. AWS is providing a lot of different runtime, managed runtime, Node.js, Java, Go, .NET. But you can bring your own runtime. For instance, if you want to code your Lambda function in Rust or C++, that's doable. So obviously, choosing one runtime on another will affect the cold start duration. Another factor is the architecture. In 2021, AWS released support for ARM64. So now you can choose between x86 or ARM64. Does the infra architecture has an impact on your cold start? We will see that in a moment as well. So a lot of different factors. And the last one is actually the package type. You can deploy your Lambda function in two different options. First one is a zip package, so you basically zip everything. You send that to a Lambda, and AWS Lambda will invoke your Lambda function. But you can also package your application, your Lambda function, as an OCI image published on ECR, the container registry of AWS. So two different packaging type, so two different impact on cold start, I guess. So as you can see, there's a lot of factors. And if you multiply the number of combination, code size, memory size, runtime, architecture, package type, that's a lot of different options. That's why I built a benchmark. So the benchmark is basically open source, because I really believe in open source. And especially for a benchmark, you want to know what's going on. You want to be sure that this is a fair benchmark. And to be fair, I chose to use Hello World Lambda function. So it might be not super representative for your actual project, but at least it's like apple to apple comparison. So no external dependency. It's bare bone Hello World Lambda function written in 30 different runtimes. So obviously managed runtime, but also custom runtimes such as Rust, C++, Apple Swift Bun, which was released a month ago. So a lot of different runtimes. What is really important with the benchmark as well is to be always up to date. Because I'm sure you've seen a lot of different blog posts mentioning benchmark on different runtimes. But the thing is, with this benchmark, it's running every day. Every night, everything is deleted and recreated. And we are going to see how. So it's always up to date. Every day, new runtime, new Lambda function are deployed, and the cold start is measured. So it's always up to date. And it's running for about 1 year. So you can see that it's actually working. So I test different memory size configuration, 128 up to 1024, two different architecture, ARM and x86, two package type, zip and OCI images. So daily, it's over 5,000 invocations. I invoke every Lambda function 10 times to have a fair average. Could be more. Maybe on the next step, we will see that maybe 101,000 invocation per combination would be better, but for now 10 is fine. So deploy over 500 different Lambda function, different combinations, so 10 times 500 for Lambda function, 5,000 invocation. So if you want to have a look, feel free to scan the QR code. And let's see how it's working. So the first step is reading a manifest. So as you can see, it's a JSON file. Very easy to contribute, actually. So if you want another runtime, you basically add an item in this JSON object, JSON array. So the display name for the nice UI, the runtime, the architecture. For instance, we can see that SnapStart is not supported on ARM64, so there is no way to deploy that. So basically, it's a description file. Every combination is recorded in this manifest file. Then we need to deploy a function. Then we need to actually invoke this function. And we need to read the report logline. So I'm not doing any tricky stuff to measure the round trip of a Lambda function, which may depend on the network and the connectivity issue. So basically, what I do is I read the report logline. So for every invocation, Lambda is writing what we call a report logline. So for every single invocation, Lambda writes a report logline. And for cold starts, we have the init duration information. So basically, the information is here. I just need to read it, and that's it. So no tricky measurements, not valid measurements. So I really read what AWS is giving to us in init duration. And as you can see, there's other very useful information, such as max memory used, actual duration outside of cold start. So all of those information is what you're seeing in the UI. So everything is coming from this report logline. Then, once every Lambda function has been invoked, I retrieve all of those information from the report logline and build a JSON result file. And since it's open source and I want to keep track of the historical data, everything is committed to Git, so you can have access to it. It's running from last year, the 4th of September, so like a long list of JSON file, one for every day. So let's have a look at the architecture. Once again, it's 100% serverless. So the first one is a trigger deployer Lambda function, which will basically loop over every runtime that you saw in the JSON file and put that message into a queue. So in this queue, there will be a lot of different messages and one message for each permutation. So one message could be Node.js 18, version package zip, 128, ARM, for instance. So one message for each permutation. From this queue, then a Lambda function will be invoked. And remember, Lambda function is event-based. So you need an event to trigger the Lambda function. So trigger deploy is invoked via event bridge cron task. So every day at 9 AM on my time zone, a message will be sent to the trigger deployer. It will deploy the Lambda function. The deployer will be woken up from the deployer queue. So as soon as a message is available in this queue, this Lambda function will start and deploy Lambda function. So as I mentioned, it's a bit of an inception because the Lambda function is actually creating Lambda function. So every day, once again, everything is erased and new Lambda functions are deployed. So if we have a look, it's a small subset of the Lambda function deployed. As you can see, SnapStart, Swift, Node.js, Python, in every combination possible, so ARM, x86, so a lot of different permutations. So one Lambda function for every permutation. Then we need to invoke those Lambda functions. So every message will go back to a queue, which is an invoker queue. And once again, this event will be fed to a new Lambda function, which only role is to invoke. But remember, we need to measure cold start. So obviously, the first invocation will be a cold start, but the 9 after that won't be cold starts. So we need to update configuration. So basically, I'm updating like an environment variable just to make sure that the Lambda function will respawn. Every invocation will generate a report logline. So every Lambda function has a CloudWatch subscription log attached to it. So every invocation will generate a report log message. And remember, a Lambda function is event-based. So an event can be a cron job, can be a SNS queue, but it can also be when a message is written into CloudWatch. So every time a report logline message is written into CloudWatch, this will trigger another and a final Lambda function, which is basically a regex function reading the report logline and extracting values. So init duration, memory size, max memory size, duration, and so on. Finally, this information it will be stored into a DynamoDB table, which look like this. So request ID, why not? It's useless to store it, but why not? The display name for the UI, the duration, init duration, the Lambda which is responsible to emit this report logline, and the max memory size, and some other fields all taken from this report logline. So cool. Now we have every data into our DynamoDB table. So now we can write a query to build a JSON result file and commit that to Git. And this is what you're seeing on the Lambda perf. This is the data. So 100% serverless architecture. Everything is automatically triggered at 9 a.m. every day. And this architecture is really scalable. So if we want to add more runtime, more combination, everything is asynchronous. So we can add a lot of different options, and we won't run into any problems. So let's have a look at the results. Rust and C++ are our winners. That's great, because I'm a big fan of Rust. Rust is allowing to have like an extremely small binary, almost no memory allocation, so that's why it's a winner. As I mentioned, I tested with different memory size, but it has very low impact, because between 128 and 1024, the number of vCPU is not changing that much. And for a Hello World Lambda function, there is no allocation, so memory size does not really matter. LRM is faster in all combinations. So one recommendation that I can give you today, if you can, if you're not using some architecture-specific binary, please use LRM64. It's basically one line change into your InfraS code project. Zip package is faster than OCA images, at least for Hello World. So maybe that's not true for more complex architecture or more complex Lambda function. But the package is faster. And the newer runtime may not perform better at release time, but are fine-tuned over time. So one example I can give is, for instance, AWS released Node 20. And Node 20 is outperformed by Node 18 as of today. But I'm sure that over the time, it will be performing better, as Node.js 18 was outperforming Node.js 16. And last but not least, does it really matter? If you have an application which runs on the client side, or the latency is really important, this is really matter. But if you're running like a batch or a nightly job, maybe call start duration is not that important for you. So before making change to your architecture, just remember that, do I really care about those 200 milliseconds for my call start? Maybe yes, and maybe you should switch to Rust. Maybe no, and what you're doing is already great. So what's next? Maybe more runtime. AWS is releasing new runtime, not every day, but this year has been like a quite intensive year in terms of new release of runtime. Maybe new memory size, and maybe new region as well. Because everything that I've shown you runs on the US East 1, but maybe on EU West 1 is different. Maybe on the Africa zone or Asia zone, maybe it's different. So maybe I will update that. Obviously, this is open source, so contributions are very welcome. And I really want to thank everyone who already contributed to this project. I don't know if someone is here, but thank you so much. I even got some contribution from AWS employees, so this is great. So thank you so much for your contribution if you hear this message. And one last but not least, make sure you check the session by AJ, my coworker at DataDog. It was today, but make sure you're checking the replay. It has been an extremely interesting session, very going deep dive into the cold starts and explaining a lot of different stuff in cold starts. So make sure you check that. That's it for me. I hope you really enjoyed it. Make sure you complete the survey. It's very helpful for me to adjust.